Okay, student, today I'm going to do with you all, I'm going to teach you all the topic of checks. And when I'm doing this topic of checks, we are going to refer to the Bill of Exchange Act. However, first of all, let us have a look at the image of a check here. So this is a sample of a check from Maybank, Malay Banking. Why? Because I'm going to introduce to you the parties to the check. Who are actually the parties to the check? So a check will have the drawer. The drawer, this is the owner of the check, because the account is actually his account. He is known as the drawer. So the drawer, the signature of the drawer will appear here. So meaning if the drawer drew this check, meaning he gave the instruction to his bank to make the payment. This is his bank, and the bank is known as the drawee. The check need to be drawn on the bank. Okay, so this check, the drawee is the Maybank, and that this check need to be paid to here. The name of the payer is Persatuan Penduduk JPP Jua. This the person who holds the check. The payment have to be made to this person. This person is known as the payee. So this check, they must have these three parties to a check: the drawer, the payee, and also the drawee. Okay, so check actually can be negotiated. What is the meaning of negotiated? Boleh diurus niagakan. So meaning a check can be used like money. You wanted to buy something, you can use a check instead of paying with money. Or if you have a check which is being given to you by others, you can also use this check to make payment. So checks are of two types, which is payable to order and also payable to bearer. So this check is a payable to order check. So what is the difference between a payable to order check and a payable to bearer check? A payable to order check, the name of the payee will appear there. So in this check, who is the payee? Persatuan Penduduk JPP Dua. So this check is payable to order. If it is a payable to bearer check, then the name of the payee will not appear there. So maybe the drawer wrote it as pay cash or pay bearer. So that check become payable to bearer. So meaning if a check is a payable to bearer check, the name of the payee does not appear there, anybody can go to the bank, take this check and request for payment. Just go to the counter of the bank, go to the counter of Maybank, because in this case it's a Maybank check. If the names of the payee does not appear there, meaning this is a payable to bearer check, just go to the counter of Maybank and claim payment. So this is for payable to bearer check. If this is payable to order check, then only the payee can claim the payment. So meaning in this case, only Persatuan Penduduk JPP Dua can claim payment of this amount of the check. So when the check is being drawn, so this check is not that safe one. So when we draw a check, so we must make sure there should not be any space there. So if there is a space like here, you should draw a line there and initial it, so that other parties will not later on insert other wording in between that check. Okay. So for payable to order check, in this case, how can actually the check be negotiated? A check can be negotiated by transferring the check to other parties. If it's payable to bearer, then it's easier to do that. Why? So let's say I have a payable to bearer check. So how am I supposed to negotiate a check? Macam mana nak urus niagakan check payable to bearer? So I have a check, the check says pay cash. So I just hand over the check to, let's say, to Amina. So just hand over the check, just transfer the check to Amina, because it's a payable to bearer check. So in that situation, now who is the holder of the check? Amina is the new holder of the check. Amina can just go to the bank and claim for payment because it is a payable to bearer check. However, if it is a payable to order check and the payee wanted to negotiate the check, can't the payee just transfer the check to the other parties? Cannot, because the name of the payee appears there. Then how actually the payee is going to negotiate this check? So under that situation, the payee need to endorse first. Endorse, what is an endorsement? So endorsement, so let's say I have a check, the check says pay Tite Soba. So what I'm supposed to do? Can I just transfer the check to Amina? Cannot. So I must make an endorsement. So meaning behind of the check, this is the front page of the check. This is behind the check. So behind the check, so I must write it down there, pay Amina and sign the check. Okay, and then only I give this check to Amina. Okay, then only I transfer the check to Amina. So this is known as endorsement, and that's how a payable to order check is being negotiated. Can later on Amina negotiate this check further? Can't. So let's say now Amina wanted to pay Zulkifli because she bought a laptop from Zulkifli. She just write it down there, pay Zulkifli. And then Amina will sign there Amina. So where is the check now? The check now is with Zulkifli. Zulkifli is the holder of the check, and of course, now Zulkifli can go to my bank and claim the amount. Okay? Okay. So this is known as endorsement. Let I show you an example of endorsement. So this is a sample of endorsement which is being done at the back of the check. So that is the front of the check. This is the back of the check. So this check is being drawn on the bank. The name of the bank is the State Bank of Narca. So this is not a Malaysian check, somewhere else. So it's, the check is quite blur, but we can read it here. Pay GL something, and how it is being negotiated, then that GL fellow, he signed here behind on the check and shot it there. Okay, so that's how he negotiated the said check. Okay, so that's how I do it also just now. I say pay Amina and I sign here, so this is known as endorsement. So check. The check is of two types, payable to order and payable to order. This is how you are going to negotiate the check. So the holder of the check is also of two kinds of holder. One is holder in due course and the other one is holder for value. Who is actually a holder in due course and who is actually a holder for value? A holder in due course is the person who holds the check after that person has given value for the check. So my example just now, I have a check. The check says pay Tite Soba. So let's say I receive the check from my friends. Why my friends give me the check? My friends give me the check because I give an advice to him. So let's say the check, the amount of the check is 2,000 ringgit, right? So now I pay the check to Amina. Why I pay the check to Amina? Because let's say I wanted to buy a headphone from Amina. Okay. So meaning, how did Amina get the check from me? Because I bought a headphone from Amina. So now he pays Zulkifli because he bought a headphone for 2,000 ringgit, let's say. So he pays Zulkifli. So with that 2,000 ringgit now, Zulkifli pay, let's say, Zulkifli pay IT Enterprise. Why he pay IT Enterprise? Because he wanted to buy a laptop. And then Zulkifli signed it. Zulkifli. So where is the check now? The check is with IT Enterprise. IT Enterprise is still a holder in due course. So now the owner of IT Enterprise hands over, transfer the check to Nancy. Then he signed here, pay Nancy. Why he hand over the check to Nancy? Because Nancy is, let's say, the owner's daughter and it is her birthday. So he gave the check to Nancy as the birthday present and chalked that IT Enterprise. The endorsement is there. So Nancy here is a holder for venue. Okay, so from the word it sounds as if holder for venue is the person who have given venue. No, it's not that way. Holder in due course is the one who gave it, who have given venue. Holder for venue does not give any venue. However, the venue have been given previously. Somebody else earlier have given venue. Okay, he herself has never given venue. She received the said check as a gift. So Nancy in this situation is actually a holder for venue. So okay, now let us have a look at the definition of a check, a characteristic of a check. So these characteristic, the five characteristic of a check is actually a combination of Section 73 and Section 3 of the Bills of Exchange Act 1949. So from the wording of the said sections, so that's how we derive actually this is the definition, or this actually is the characteristic of a check. So a check, first thing, it must be an unconditional order in writing. So just now we have seen a sample of a check. It must be in writing, it cannot be done orally. And there must not be any condition attached to it. So let's say if the check says pay Tite Soba if she produce a driving license, then under that situation that check is not a valid check. Why? Because there is a condition attached to the said check. So there must not be any condition attached to it. So that is the first characteristic of check. And secondly, it must be signed by the drawer. Because if the check is not signed by the drawer, the check is not a valid check. You take the check to the counter, the bank will not pay you any money. So that's why it needs to be signed by the drawer, because it shows that the drawer agreed to pay that amount of money. And thirdly, it must be drawn on a bank. The drawing must be a bank. So the drawee cannot be Along or somebody else. It must be a registered bank. And fourthly, actually, a check is actually an order to the banker. It orders the banker to pay a certain amount in money, certain sum in money on demand. So if the amount of money is not certain, then the check is not a valid check. So the amount of money, it can be whether in rupiah or in Malaysian ringgit or in Singapore dollar or in baht, as long as it is certain amount of money. So if the amount can be made certain, let's say the check says pay Titik Soba the amount of 2000 ringgit plus 10% interest, it is still valid. Why? Because 10% interest can still be determined. You can calculate how much is actually 10%. And then finally, a check is drawn in favor of the payee. So if the name of the payee appears there, so it's drawn in favor of that specific person. The sample I given you just now, pay Titik Soba, so I am that specific person, or to his order. If I do this endorsement, I order that the check is to be paid to Amina, or in favor of a bearer. If the check is a payable to bearer check, the check says pay cash. Okay, so now let us have a look at the types of check. So we have undated check. What is an undated check? An undated check is a check which does not have a date there. Of course, this is not a valid check. If you take this check to the bank will not honor your check. So the first thing you need to do, if you have a check, if the drawer fails to put the date, you can fill in the date so that it becomes a valid check. However, make sure that the date is within the time frame, okay? And the secondly, it's overdue or stale check yang basi, that expired, okay? So, why I said this is the check which had already expired? Because a check is only valid within 6 months. So, if a party wanted to negotiate the check like this by endorsing it, make sure it is in circulation within 6 months from the date it is issued, from the date which is written on the check. Because after 6 months, if you take it to the bank, then the bank will not make payment because it is already expired. Okay. Thirdly, this is antedated check. Antedated check is a backdated check. It's a backdated check. So let's say if I issue a check today, however I put a date 2 months back, it is still valid because it's within 6 months. So this is known as a backdated check. And finally, it's a postdated check. A postdated check is a check which bears a date in future. So let's say I issue a check, however I put the date on the check, so now it's actually November, I put a date, a December date, 1 month after today. So why people issue a postdated check? Because at the moment I don't have money in my account, so because of that, so I wanted to make sure when the payee demand for payment, there is money in my account, and I'm sure around December I have enough money in my account, so that's why I issue a post-dated check. So a post-dated check actually is not a valid check. So meaning if you go to the bank and take this check to the bank will not make payment. So you have to wait until the check becomes matured, until the check reach that date. So meanwhile, you can still negotiate your check by doing this, by doing endorsement. If there are people who is willing to accept that check. Okay, so now we are going to go on with the next topic, which is crossing of check. What is actually crossing? A crossing is this two parallel transverse lines appearing on the face of the check. Okay, why we do this crossing? Why a check is being crossed? Because once a check is being crossed, then parties cannot obtain payment from the counter of the bank, meaning that it's more difficult to obtain payment once there is a crossing on a check. So that is the effect of crossing. So once the collecting banker, so the bank of the drawer is known as the collecting banker. We have Maybank here, right? So this Maybank is known as the collecting banker. So once the collecting banker, meaning the bank of the drawer, saw this crossing. I'm sorry, this is known as the paying banker. The collecting banker is the banker of the payee. Okay, so that's all. Please make sure you don't get it wrong, because the paying banker is Maybank, the bank of the drawer, whereas the collecting banker is the bank of the payee. So once the paying banker saw this crossing, then the paying banker knew actually the drawer has instructed them not to make payment at the counter. So they have to be very careful, because once they saw this crossing, they know they cannot pay the person who holds the check. Meaning the payment can only be made to the collecting banker. Who is the collecting banker? The collecting banker is the banker of the pay. So let's say if the check is issued under my name, Titik Soba, meaning I must have a bank account. Okay? because my bank only can collect this amount of money of the check. So let's say my bank is Bank Simpanan Nasional. So Bank Simpanan Nasional is the collecting banker, and Maybank is the bank of who? Is the bank of the drawer. Maybank is the paying banker. So once there is crossing like this, the paying banker can only pay Bank Simpanan Nasional. So meaning if I take this check, I go to the counter, will Maybank pay me? No. Maybank will not pay me. Because what? Because there is an instruction already to the paying banker by the drawer not to pay at the counter. Okay? So must this line be drawn here? No. This line can be drawn anywhere on the face of the check. However, because this is only a blank space on the check, so that's why it is appropriate to make this crossing on this part of the check, because over here is the signature of the drawer. Let us go on with the next line, because inside this crossing, it can appear the words account payee or not negotiable, okay, or the name of the bank there. And crossing, and this crossing, there are two types of crossing: general crossing and also special crossing. What is the difference between this type of crossing? A general crossing is a normal crossing whereby you have these two parallel transverse lines appearing on the face of the check, and inside it can insert the words account payee or can also insert the words not negotiable. Okay, whereas a special crossing is the crossing whereby the name of the collecting banker will appear here. So let's say in this example, the name of BSN, Bank Simpanan Nasional, appear inside this crossing. So under that situation, if this is a special crossing whereby the name of the collecting banker appears here, only Bank Simpanan Nasional can collect the check. So if, let's say, the payee does not have an account at Bank Simpanan Nasional, of course then the payee need to open an account there, because other banker cannot collect this check. This is the difference between this special crossing and also general crossing. And then what is the effect actually of account payee and also not negotiable? If there is a word account payee inside that crossing, then under that situation, this check can only be paid to the account of this payee. So now the payee is me, Titik Soba. So meaning this check can only be paid to my account. So the collecting banker must make sure they are collecting for the payee and not somebody else. So what happens if we have the words there, not negotiable? If there appears the word not negotiable here, so meaning this check cannot be negotiated. So this check cannot be negotiated like this, cannot endorse and transfer the check to somebody else. However, the check can still be transferred. If it cannot be negotiated, then how can it be transferred? A cash check. A payable to bearer check, it can still be transferred. You need no need to do endorsement. So however, let us look at this case of Wilson and Mason versus Pickering, so that it is much more clearer here. So what happened in Wilson and Mason versus Pickering is this. The drawer of the check hand over the check to the clerk, and the check actually had been crossed non-negotiable. And the clerk is being instructed by the drawer to do certain payments. What happened in this case, what the clerk did not follow the instruction. Instead, what the clerk did, the clerk paid her own debt by using this check. Because this check, the name of the payee is being left blank. And because of that, what the clerk did, the clerk inserted her own creditor there to settle her own debts and gave the check, hand over the check to her creditor, meaning she transferred the check to her creditor. And under that situation, this creditor who received the check, does he receive a good title to the check? Can he claim the amount of the check? Cannot. Why? Because the person who transferred the check to him does not have a good title. So that is the effect of not negotiable crossing. So meaning if there is such a crossing and the person who transferred the check does not have good title, then the person receiving the check also does not receive good title. So actually it's good to cross not negotiable to make sure that the check will go to the person you want to make payment. It's much more secured. So what happens if that is the words of account payee? So in this case of Woodland Development versus Chartered Bank, what happened in this case? There is the check drawn in favor of Woodland Development. So however the director of Woodland Development hand over, there is three directors involved here. So one of the directors hand over the check to the other two directors, so ask them to open an account for Woodland Development so that this check can be paid into the account of Woodland Development because it's an account paying check. However, what the other two directors did is that they instructed the bank to collect the check for another company because according to them, this Woodland Development, they are also the director, the other company, they are also the director of that company. And that is what Chartered Bank did. Chartered Bank collect the check. Is it for Woodland Development? No, for the other company. And so that's why now Woodland Development is suing Chartered Bank for collecting the check for somebody else. And the court held here the bank liable. Because why? Because they have collected the bank, they have actually collected the check for somebody else and not for the payee. And the payee here is Woodland Development. So that is the effect of an account pay check and also not negotiable check. So now let's go on with alteration on a check. So there are two types of alterations. One is apparent alterations and the other one is a non-apparent alteration. What is an apparent alteration? An apparent alteration is an alteration by looking at the check, you know actually there is an alteration. So meaning the alteration is very clear and is visible to our eyes. So maybe the amount is being altered. So let's say the amount here is RM2000. And this amount is being cancelled. And on top of this, it's being returned the amount as 3000 ringgit. So this is visible to our eyes. So this is known as apparent alteration. So what is then a non-apparent alteration? A non-apparent alteration is an alteration which is not visible to our eyes. By looking at the check, we did not know that the check had been altered. So for apparent alteration, so all parties who is liable to the check, okay, will be released, meaning they will not be liable. Who are the parties who is liable on the check? The parties who had signed the check is the parties who is liable to the check. So here, not only the drawer, so let's say the drawer has signed the check here. The drawer signed it here. So the since the drawer signed the check, the drawer will be liable on this check. I also signed here, because I endorsed it, I will also be liable to the check. Okay, Zulkifli, yes, Zulkifli signed here. Zulkifli will be liable, Amina will be liable because they signed the check. Okay, however, Nancy signed the check. Nancy did not sign the check, so Nancy will not be liable to the check. So when I say liable to the check, what does it mean? It means that I can be sued for this amount of the check. So if this is an apparent alteration, I will not be liable. Because why? Because if you know that this check had already been altered, it's been modified because it's visible with the bare eyes, why actually you accept the check? Okay, so let's say Zulkifli is the one who altered the check. Okay, meaning Zulkifli knew actually that the cheque had been altered. Why? Because he is the one who altered the cheque. I did not know that the cheque is being altered because I did not alter it. Okay? So Aminah did not know that the cheque is being altered because she did not alter it. But Zulkifli altered the cheque. So he knows that he altered the cheque. Okay? So what about IT Enterprise? So when IT Enterprise received the cheque, they saw that there is an alteration because this is an apparent alteration. Then under that situation, Zulkifli will be liable. IT Enterprise also will be liable. Will Nancy be liable? Nancy will not be liable because why? Because she did not sign the check. So whoever signed the check, they will be liable on the value of the check. That is the effect of apparent alteration. What about if the alteration is not apparent? By looking at the check, we did not know that there is an alteration. So let's say a magic pen or whatsoever is being used here. So now the amount is being altered from 2,000 ringgit to 3,000 ringgit. And nobody is aware of this. What is the effect of this? The effect of this is similar to apparent alteration. The difference is just that the person who did not alter the check, who did not alter the check? I did not alter the check. I mean now, not alter the check, we will be liable on the original amount only. What is the original amount? 2,000 ringgit. So meaning, if let's say IT Enterprise wanted to sue me and Amina, how much amount they are entitled to sue? Only 2,000 ringgit, the original amount. Yeah, however, of course, Zulkifli, IT Enterprise, they are liable on the altered amount, the 3,000 ringgit. Okay, so now let us go on with the topic of customer's duty of care. Who is the customer? The drawer. The drawer is the customer of the bank. Because a bank is drawn, because the check is drawn on the bank. Check dikeluarkan atas nama bank. Okay, so as a customer of this check, let's say the customer here is Tan Ah Chong. Now, Tan Ah Chong sign here, Tan Ah Chong. So, Tan Ah Chong owes a duty of care. Dia mempunyai tanggungjawab untuk berjaga-jaga, owes a duty of care to make sure that the check that he issued will not be altered. He owes this duty of care. He cannot be negligent. Dia tidak boleh cuai. Why? Because if he is negligent and there is alteration, and the alteration is not visible to the eyes, and because of that, the paying banker pays the amount because they did not know that actually there is alteration, then Tan Ah Chong will be liable. Why? Because he is negligent, he owes a duty of care to the paying banker, and he did not exercise his duty. So this is what happened in the case of London Joint Stock Bank versus Macmillan and Arthur. So what happened in this case is this. The drawer in this case, they issue a check. The amount is actually £2. However, they leave a blank space. So I show you like this. They leave, this is a payable to bearer check, meaning the name of the payee does not appear there. It's a bearer check, pay cash. And is actually £2. However, the drawer leave a blank space here, and there is also a blank space here. And the amount was not written in words, meaning this is blank. So what happened in this case is that the clerk who worked for the drawer filled in the amount as 120. He inserted number 1 and inserted 0 here. And then fill in the words in the fill in the amount in words as £120. So the bank is not aware that there is alterations. And because of that, the bank pays this amount to the holder. Will the bank be liable? No, the bank is not liable. Why? Because in this case, is the negligence of the drawer. So this is the customer duty of care. So as the customer of course need to exercise his duty of care. You have to be careful, you have to make sure that the check will not be altered because of his negligence. So now let's go on with topic of protection of the paying banker. Who is the paying banker? The paying banker is the bank of the drawer. The bank whereby the name appears on the check. So why actually the paying banker need to be protected? If they make payment wrongly and they are not negligent, okay, of course, and they are good faith meaning that the bank does not have this bad intention, they will be protected under these situations. What are these situations? The first one, when payment is being done in due course. What does it mean payment is being done in due course? So when payment is being done in due course, this is for payable to bearer check. So meaning under that situation, the payment is being done by the bank when the check had already reached its maturity date. So if this is a post-dated check, the check had already reached that date already and the bank pays it on that date. So under the situation, if the bank pays the holder in good faith, meaning he pays the holder of the check without any bad intentions, then the bank will be protected. However, if the said check is an order check meaning the names of the payee appears here, and then the check is being endorsed by the payee and the endorsement is actually forged, then the bank will not be protected under number one. Why? Because the bank will be protected under number two, right? So that's why I'm going to discuss number two. This is under section 60, whereas number one is under section 59. So number one, this is for check which is payable to bearer, whereas number two, this is for those check which is payable to order. Because for those check which is payable to order, it need to be endorsed before it can be negotiated. Meaning the parties cannot just simply take the check to the bank and ask for payment. If the check is payable to bearer, of course the parties can do that. So for those check which is payable to order under number two, what happens if, let's say, the endorsement is being forged? Well, this paying maker does not have the specimen signature of the payee or the other endorser. The paying banker knows only the signature of their client, which is the drawer. So if the signature of the drawer is the one who is being forged and the bank make payment, then under that situation, of course, the bank will be liable. Why? Because you should check. This is your client. How come you do not know the signature of your client? So under that situation, if this signature is being forged, tanda tangan ini, drawer ini yang dipalsukan, maka bank tak akan dilindungi. So meaning the bank will be liable. Bank they need to pay back the money which they have paid to the third party. Kena bayar balik lah drawer. Okay, so why you are not careful, why you don't check? This is not the signature of the drawer actually. However, as I told you earlier, the bank is not aware of the signature because the bank do not know, because they are not his client, okay? The bank do not know what the signature of the payee looks like, the signature of the other endorser looks like. So if it is this endorsement which is being forged, then under that situation, the bank will still be protected under section 60 if the bank pays in good faith. Good faith meaning the bank does not have bad intention. When I say bad intention, meaning no fraud involved and payment is being done during business hours. Okay, that shows that the bank pays in good faith, then under that situation, the bank will still be protected. And what happened if this is an order check, there is no endorsement and the bank pays the money. The bank will still be protected if the bank is in good faith also and the bank pays in the ordinary course of business. So then you'll be asking, if let's say there is no endorsement, why the bank pays? So if let's say the check is hand over to me, I am the holder, my name appears here, Kitik Foba, I go to the bank, I claim the amount, I go to the bank, I claim the amount, I am the holder, and the bank pay me. I did not endorse the check. Then the bank will be protected because I am the holder of the check and I am the payer of this check. This is payable to order and I'm the one claiming the amount and the bank pays me, then of course the bank will be protected. However, most of the time, because the bank wanted to protect themselves, they will ask actually the bank to endorse behind the check. However, if the bank did not do that, the bank will still be protected here as long as the bank is in good faith. Selagi bank itu suci hati, tidak berniat jahat, okay, bank masih dilindungi. So what about cross-check? Cross-check will involve collecting banker, right? Because cross-check, you cannot make payment at the counter. So meaning, the collecting banker is the one who will go to the bank, to Maybank, and collect money. And of course, Maybank wouldn't know actually whether this collecting banker is collecting the money for the right person. They wouldn't know. Then under that situation, of course, the paying banker will be protected if, let's say, the crossing is being altered or added, or maybe it's not apparent, the bank will still be protected as long as they are not negligent and they pay in good faith. Okay, so let us have a look at the case of Slingsby versus District Bank. What happened in this case? In this case, this lawyer is being given a check and the pay of the check is, what is the name of the payee of the check? Let me have a look first. Okay, let us have a look at the case of Slingsby with the District Bank. So what happened in this case? A lawyer is being handed over a check and the payee of the check is John Pras and Company. So meaning the lawyer holds the check as a trustee and he is supposed to pay the check to John Pras and Company. But what did the lawyer did? The lawyer inserted, because why? Because here the drawer leave a blank space here. So that's why I say don't leave a blank space. If you leave a blank space, then maybe somebody else will insert something. So what the drawer did? The drawer wrote the name there, John Pras and Company. However, there is a blank space here. And hand over the check to the lawyer, to the solicitor. The solicitor is actually only a trustee and the solicitor is supposed to hand over, to give this check to John Price and Company. But what did the solicitor do? The solicitor inserted their full name. They inserted that Per Cumberbatch and Pott. So meaning now, who is the payee now? The payee now become John Price and Company, Per Cumberbatch and Pott. Jadilah peluang ni kan? So, check patut bayar pada John Pras and Company. Apa lawyer buat? Lawyer tu tampak nama syarikat dia kat sini. So now, the name of the payee become John Pras and Company Per Cumberbatch and Pott. And what did the lawyer did? The lawyer then endorsed the check. So the lawyer endorsed the check. I told you just now, if this is an order check, you want to negotiate, you need to endorse. However, the lawyer endorsed it only as Per Cumberbatch and Pott. The lawyer wanted to claim payment, so the lawyer endorsed the check at least. Okay? And the collecting banker then collect the same check. And the bank pay the amount of money. So under this situation, one, the bank is liable, because the bank did not check actually the endorsement. The endorsement should be John Pras and Company Per Cumberbatch and Pott. Lawyer tu nak ambil duit tu, apa dia buat? Dia buat endorsement. Lawyer tu buat endorsement tapi dia sign Per Cumberbatch and Pott. And the bank paid. bank should check first. There is endorsement, right? The endorsement must be read as John Price and Company endorsement. Patutnya nama ni lah. John Price and Company per Cumberbatch Airport. Bukan Cumberbatch Airport saja. So because of that, the bank is being made liable. Okay, that is the protection of the paying banker. Now let us have a look at the protection of the collecting banker. The collecting banker, when it involves crossing, if there is no crossing, most of the time you don't have collecting banker. Because what? When it involves crossing, when there is crossing, check cannot be collected at the counter. Check need to bank in into your account. Your bank will collect the check. And these collecting banker also, they need to be protected under the law. Why they need to be protected under the law? Because if they don't want to collect the money on behalf of their client, they will be sued by the client for breach of contract. However, if they collect money for the wrong person, then they might also be sued because of wrongly converting somebody else's property as their property. So they will be sued under wrongful conversion. So that's why the bank need to be protected. So that's why under the Bill of Exchange Act, under Section 85, Subsection 1, if this collecting banker is in good faith, puji hati, tak ada niat buruk, and they are not negligent dan tidak cuai, they will be protected. Mereka akan dilindungi. However, before they are entitled to that protection, they need to prove these three things. Kena buktikan dulu tiga perkara ini. First, they act for a customer. Memang mereka bertindak untuk seorang pelanggan, for a customer. How are they supposed to prove this? So that's why before a customer opens a bank account, that bank have to check who is actually this customer. So that's why most of the time, a bank will ask for a referee. Not only when you apply for a job, you need to have a referee in your resume. If you want to open a bank account also, you need to have a referee. However, most of the time in Malaysia, a bank don't ask for a referee. Why? If you go to the bank, you realize or not, the bank will ask for your IC, and your IC will be inserted in this machine, and then all your particulars will appear there. So, because actually your IC, your MyCard acts like a referee actually. However, if this is a foreigner, then the bank is unable to do that. Then under this situation, the bank will ask for a referee. So that's why I think most of the time in Malaysia, the bank did not ask for a referee. However, if the bank wanted to be protected, okay, then under this situation, most of the time, they will ask for a referee. And secondly, the bank also must act in good faith. Bank juga mestilah bersikap suci hati. They does not have bad intention. They have to prove this. And then thirdly, the bank must act without negligence. If the bank can prove actually they are good faith, memang suci hati, tak ada niat buruk, tapi cuai, however they are negligent, the bank will still be liable. So that's why the bank has to be very careful, because if not, they will be held negligent. So when will the bank, the collecting banker, of course, will be held negligent? If this situation occurs, then under that circumstances, the bank will be held as negligent. Number one, if the check is in favor of a company and the bank allows it to be credited in the private account. So let's say I have a company. My company is TT Sdn Bhd. And I am actually the director of the company. My company, I formed the company and I am the director of the company. However, there is a check which is being issued under my company name, meaning the pay is TT Sdn Bhd. Can then the bank collect the money on my behalf and put it inside my private account, TT Sobat account? Cannot. The bank will be held liable, meaning the check have to be collected for my company and not for me. Because under that situation, the collecting banker will be held liable. And secondly, if the check is being issued under this official capacity, however, the bank credited it in that person's private account, So this is normal. Let's say you need to make payment to your ITM, your check will state that pay benda hari your ITM, right? Pay the treasury. Does this check belong to the treasury, belong to the bendahari? No, it belongs to the ITM, to your ITM. And if the bank collected the check for that bendahari, the bank, again, will be held liable. And thirdly, if the check is in favor of a principal, meaning the payee is the principal, however, the bank credited it, put it inside the account of the agent, then again, if the bank will be liable. So in the case of the bank, this is what happened, the solicitor, this lawyer, fraudulently, okay, collect the account, collect the amount of the check and put it inside his own account, and the collecting banker allows this to be done, then under the situation, the collecting banker is held liable. Fourthly, when the check is an account payee check, remember I told you, when there is a crossing and there is the word account payee there, the bank have to make sure that this amount goes to the payee. The collecting banker have to make sure of this. So what happened in this case of Rubber Industry Replanting Board versus Hong Kong and Shanghai Bank is this: the check is being issued in favor of Toh Wai Tech. However, then this man who found the check with me, he opened up an account and put that chop to white tank and collected the amount. And the bank collected it and put inside this account. Then the bank is being held liable because chop to white tank and to white tank is not the same person. Okay, under this situation, the bank is held liable. And number five, if suddenly the amount is not like usual, the collecting banker realized the amount is not like usual and still collect the amount, then under the situation, the bank will also be held liable. So this is what happened in Lloyds Bank, also Standard Bank of India. So what happened in that case is that this employee of the bank, this employee is being given power to draw checks, meaning this employee can sign check and draw checks. Okay? And what he did is that he draws this check and pays into his own private account, and altogether is 19 checks, and the bank never checked. The bank should make inquiry. Of course, this is not a collection of salary, because salary will not be that much. Okay, under that situation, the bank will also be liable because it did not make any inquiry. And lastly, if the bank did not check who is actually his customer, okay. So that's why a bank need to have a referee, because they need to check who is actually their customer. And in this case, Hapstead Guided versus Barclay Bank, this is what happened. The bank did request for a referee, and the referee gave a very good remarks with regards to this customer, when actually the referee is the customer himself. Bank tak periksa pun. Rupanya referee orang yang menjadi orang rujukan itu adalah customer itu sendiri. Of course, because he is himself, he write good things about himself. Then under that situation, the bank is being held liable. Lastly, let us check on the collecting banker and also contributory negligence. Contributory negligence is actually a defense which can be used by a collecting banker if there is a claim made towards the collecting banker. So what is being done by the collecting banker is actually this. The collecting banker is trying to say that I am not the only one who is to be blamed. However, this fellow also need to be blamed, and let us share the damage. That is the meaning of claiming contributory negligence, whereby the collecting banker is said that these parties is also contributing to the negligence. Maksudnya, bank cuba mengatakan bahawa bukan dia seorang sahaja yang cuai, orang ni juga cuai, dan orang ini pun kenalah juga menanggung bersama-sama dengannya kerugian tersebut. So why the bank is trying to do this? Because the bank is trying to reduce the damage which they need to pay. So this is what happened in Lumsden and Company versus London Trustee. So in this case, the bank agreed actually they failed to ask for a proper referees. However, according to the bank, the plaintiff is also negligent. Why? Because when they draw the check, they leave a blank space. And because of that, the drawer also will be liable. So they are sharing the liabilities under that situation. Okay, that's all under the topic of check. Okay, if you have any questions, you can post your questions to me. Thank you, students.